Uno, via.
Explorers, adventurers, scientists. The ones who always broadened our horizons. We were at their side when they reached the deepest point in the oceans, the highest summits of the Earth, and both poles. We may think we've seen it all, that the world has its limits after all. But why do explorers, adventurers, scientists continue to venture out there again and again? Certainly not just for the record. So what do they seek, really? To understand more intimately how complex and delicate our planet is. To document its change and how we can affect it for the better. As long as they need it, we will be at their side. Because today, the real discovery is not so much about finding new lands. It's about looking with new eyes at the marvels of our planet, rekindling our sense of wonder and acting here and now to preserve this pale blue dot and make it perpetual.
Buonasera a tutti, grazie di essere.
Good evening. Thank you for being with us. We're carrying on with the Science Festival 2021 with this event we are organizing with Rolex. We thank all our participants. We talk about the highest mountain in the world, the challenges, climate change, with our extraordinary guests, whom I will introduce shortly. Before moving to our guests, we'll talk about the Rolex Perpetual Planet Expedition. We began in 2019. Some of our guests here today are part of that project. So I'll start off by showing a brief video that presents the expedition. So let's show the video.
This is a different expedition than we ever had before.
We're working where basically no other scientists work.
This is the highest place in the world.
The climate is changing.
These glaciers are melting.
It's very important to predict how fast it's going to happen and how it's going to influence humans.
Mount Everest is part of the Himalayas. We're here on a 2-month expedition with National Geographic.
It is coming.
The largest scientific expedition ever conducted on Mount Everest. The scientists involved in this program came from glaciology,
shifted a little bit here.
Geology, meteorology,
both panels in here,
biology, and also from mapping.
This is an important contribution to understanding how change is occurring and the implications of that change for the entire Northern Hemisphere.
The ultimate goal of this project is to turn the science into something that has value for the people.
Okay, benissimo. Dopo questo video molto bello.
Excellent. So that was a very interesting video which presents the expedition and the project. I will now move on to our first guest, Dawa Yangzum Sherpa, an extraordinary athlete. She has made some excellent feats. She's the first woman in Nepal to become an IFMGA official guide. She climbed Mount Everest when she was 21 and several other mountains over 8,000 meters high, the K2, Makalu, and Annapurna with no oxygen. She is the first woman from Nepal to climb both mountains, Alagiri, Malakma, all peaks above 8,000 meters, seven of the 14 peaks exceeding 8,000 meters. So, extraordinary feats. I would like to start off from Mount Everest. I would like you to tell us how was climbing Everest compared to other mountains? Was it more difficult? Was it the most relevant, the most significant? What can you tell us about your experience?
Hi, everyone. So honored to be in the team, and I'm so grateful that I'm able to join. So climbing Mount Everest always become a dream because it's in the highest mountain in the world. And since I'm my teenage, I grew up on the mountain. I born in a very remote village, which is 14,000 feet, means 4,200 meter. And growing up in a mountain, I grew up without electricity and no running water, and life was quite hard. But I grew up around the mountain, and my dream was always want to be able to climb Mount Everest since very young age. So because of women, I had to train harder than other women just to climb Mount Everest. And finally, when I was 21, I was able to climb Mount Everest, and I had to train for like 5 to 6 years, and because nobody was able to take me, and because I was a girl, so it's a different kind of challenging for me to climb Everest. And because I was a woman, I was first woman from my hometown to climb Mount Everest. So I had to train harder, and I was a kind of small girl, so proving other people that I can also climb mountain was a bit harder in our culture, because it was 10 years ago. So for Everest, my first time Everest, I worked as not a guide, but I was just a kind of porter that I was carrying a load, and it was way difficult. Then now I've been climbing. This year I've been climbed a 48,000 meter in one season, one year. Annapurna, Dalagiri, Manaslu, and Hotse I climbed in 1 year. But before, like when I work on Everest, it is much more difficult because it is very popular, and working there is kind of a hard than just climbing another 8,000 meter with a supporting team. And of course, walking through a Khumbu icefall, which is a very dangerous part, and going through icefall and the Western Khum is one of the very scariest part of for us, for the Sherpa or whoever working. Because its altitude is really low, but because even if it's not a big altitude, the risk is much higher than higher. For the above dead zone, above 8,000 meter for the Westerner is kind of very risky because of the tenure and the environment there was so difficult to work and to deal everything. But for us, for the Sherpa people who are more adapted in altitude, are more risks in those zones. And I think those type of things are very difficult than other mountain. And of course, all the mountain are so dangerous and hard to climb, but Everest is, because Everest has a big name and a lot of traffic jam was one of the more risks on Everest, and working on those condition, working on those jams, it may not happen what we planned. So I think those are the most difficult, and and of course it's a very high in altitude, and
Grazie, grazie.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can you tell us something more about being an IMFGA guide? What does it mean to you? What is your job consist in?
Yeah, so I'm so proud to represent my country, and as a Nepali female and as an Asian, I'm only one still, and I'm first female from Nepal. So in 2021, I work as a porter. I was caring up. I was very shy to Western people. My English was not good, and I used to panic when I saw what to talk English. And I always dreamed to climb Mount Everest because a lot of men from my hometown used to go and climb Mount Everest. And so I say, okay, I will climb Mount Everest. And that was my dream, the last dream. But then after Mount Everest, in 2021, I made quite a bit money on Everest. So then I thought, okay, I think I am able, I know my body, how I can work in 8,000. So I think I said, I want to be a professional and I want to be a certified. So I want to get a qualified and I want to represent a woman because this is a very male, there's a very dominating job in our culture that women is not, this is not the woman's job and this is beyond our culture. But even though I try to become IFMGA and I wanted, because everybody says too impossible and this is too hard. So there's no female. So that it was very important because I wanted to try if I can do it not, because I can, because there's no any girls that I can look up to in Nepal as a professional mountain guide. So even for the young generation and for the next generation of girls, I think it was more important for me to be IFMG and also working with client and for guiding, for safety and a lot of, I think it's very important to become IFMGA. And also I've been guiding in US, Europe now, in Argentina. So that also, because I got my IFMGA degree, so I was able to travel and work and learn a lot of things. And it brought a lot of change into women climbing and this guiding things that we can be porter and we can also be a very professional guide that represent not only Nepal, but as a woman. Thank you.
Grazie, grazie. Infatti, riconnettendo...
Thank you very much. Going back to what you just said, you have truly become a role model for these new climbers. You train a lot, I know. Could you quickly tell us, and then we'll hear also from the other guests, if you were to give some advice to a young climber who is following us, a young woman, a young girl who wants to climb mountains, who wants to walk and follow in your footsteps, what kind of advice would you give?
Can you repeat the one, sorry?
E che cosa consiglieresti a un giovane arrampicatore che vuole diventare?
What is your advice to a young climber who wants to become an IMFGA guide, who wants to climb mountains? What would you suggest? Yeah. What is your advice?
I think I grew up in a, for talking about me, I grew up in a very remote village and with limited facility, and I haven't went to school for, I think I completed only 5th grade. And so I think if I can do it coming from those remote village, and because then I think of course anybody can do it, because I think if you have any determination and a goal, and I think, very focused, because I focused 10 years to become a mountain guide. So I think climbing and guiding this, it takes you a long time. And I think for this kind of job, you need a lot of patience, sacrifice, and focus. So I think it's impossible, because when I came to Kathmandu city for the first time in teenage, and I didn't know how to speak English, and I even didn't know how to work in a laptop. So after 10 years, if I able to become a mountain guide internationally, and so then I think it's, if you have a goal and dream and patient, I think that's the more important in your life. And of course you have to be a determination and really disciplined in what you're doing. I think not only in a mountain guide, I think for the woman in professional, every job is so hard to balance. But yeah, I think and also my family background is not into climbing. That's also, I had a hard time getting into climbing, and I was always first one to climb Everest from my hometown, first one to become mountain guide. So it was always the first one has always to deal a lot of stuff, not physically things, but a lot of cultural things, and yeah, a lot of family matters. So I think it's just a lot of patience, and I think also you need to sacrifice some of a lot of things in life.
Grazie mille, grazie Dawa. Allora,
thank you very much. We can now move on to the second guest, but before, I'll show you a video. It's a beautiful video. It will show you in detail the expedition.
Everest is one of the most extreme environments on the planet, and nobody has ever fully quantified the climate conditions up there. We're going to be pushing the envelope, attempting to install highest weather station in the world to improve our understanding of weather patterns and climate change in the Mount Everest region. These high mountain regions are changing faster than other places around the world. The highest elevations are actually believed to be warming at faster rates than other lower elevation regions. My major role in this expedition is to install a network of weather stations, including what we hope to be the highest weather station in the world.
We're here installing the lowest of our network of weather stations. Firstly, to transmit the data, we require quite a lot of power. If the system doesn't have enough power, it will refuse to transmit data. That would mean we couldn't see what was going on in real time, which is what we really want. We want to know in real time what's going on in the mountain. The weather station sees a whole year's worth of weather possibilities, measuring the wind speed, thermal radiation, temperature, humidity, and precipitation. We can use machine learning to provide a totally different approach to how you can forecast weather. We are filling in gaps in how the climate is changing.
There are multiple stations going up, including one at Fort Say, one station at Base Camp, one in Camp 2, another at the South Col, and then we will attempt to install one above 8,000 meters.
Let's face it, climbing Everest is still a very difficult thing to do. It takes years of time developing the skills, the confidence, the ability to deal with a constantly changing mountain environment, to deal with the cold, to deal with the high altitude. And you can't fake it.
What a snob. but not so snug that I'm pushing really hard against my face.
And then just set the reducer right on top, and then you're going to be spinning the bottle counterclockwise.
This morning we have installed what we call the Base Camp Rover. It's critical to have a station here on the glacier to be able to observe and to measure the meteorological processes. We've got electronics that need to operate at extreme temperatures, exceptionally high wind speeds. Having instruments that can work in those sorts of environments has been a big challenge.
And that plane's good. So yeah, tie in everything.
You say?
He orients this out.
Yes.
There's a reason that some of this has never been done before. Logistically, it's exceptionally challenging. It's physically demanding in and of itself just to climb and function up at 1,000 meters. To try to do science up at some of these elevations is an added challenge. I think people are feeling as good as we can at this stage of the expedition, and we're excited to move up to Camp 2.
As a scientist, we're used to having to be patient with things, and this expedition has been no different. It's been nothing but eat, sleep, think Everest for the last 9 months.
Camp 2 station is in.
This environment is uncontrollable. It's hostile. It doesn't care whether we're successful on our expedition, and we have to be prepared to deal with that as best as possible.
It's about 10:45 p.m. I'd be lying if I said I wasn't a bit nervous. I am. I know how big the challenge is ahead, but I feel very confident in our team. We know that we may be limited by the weather, so we're going to try and get up there just as the sun is rising when the winds are lowest. We have maximum for oxygen about 3 hours to install the station. We need to be efficient and work as a team.
Shoot the balcony. We're going to the house. I'm not getting enough air in.
I have to lift my glass like this.
Look at
the batteries.
They're close to that. Yeah, we fit it, the batteries fit it. So, just have to wait.
I'm a bit worried we won't be able to think clearly. We may make a mistake that means we leave those stations in a position that's suboptimal, that they're not transmitting.
So we're trying to warm up the down jacket, stuff like your armpits. Sun's about to come up, we can help a bit too.
My fear is I won't know my limitation. All their efforts for nothing. It's about being resilient in the face of a mountain that really doesn't care about you.
Temperature? Yeah, it's good. The weather went.
It's a rare opportunity to come here and do a scientific expedition like this.
This is the highest weather station in the world.
That gives us information to plan for future scenarios of climate change.
I think that's 15 now for Washington, D.C. And that could be the highest that's been installed. The balcony, Everest. Thanks for Tom and all the super colleagues. You're doing such a good job.
Okay, come avete visto, bellissime immagini, bellissimo racconto di questo.
So those were great images and a wonderful story regarding an extraordinary expedition, and we have one of the members of that expedition, who I'll be introducing in a while, will be talking about his experience. Baker Perry, who is a climatologist. He's a professor of geography and planning at the Appalachian State University, North Carolina. You saw him in the video. He was one of the participants during that expedition on Mount Everest. Let me begin by asking you a little bit more about that team. It was an interdisciplinary team from the video, but what was your role? And who were the others who were involved and what were their roles?
Well, thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to share some of these experiences and talk about this very important work. As you saw in the video, this was the most comprehensive scientific expedition to Mount Everest in history. And we had 34 international and Nepali scientists representing biology, geology, glaciology, mapping, and meteorology. Our lead for the entire expedition was Dr. Paul Majewski, a renowned ice core scientist and explorer from the University of Maine. And I had the privilege of serving as the co-leader on the meteorology team with my close colleague, Dr. Tom Matthews. And we worked closely with an elite team of 15 Sherpa climbers led by Panuru Sherpa. And as you saw, Dawa Sherpa played a critical role in the overall logistics on the mountain, the installation of the weather stations, and most importantly, ensuring our safety, particularly through the Khumbu icefall and ascending and descending the very steep Lhotse face. There were other key members of our Sherpa team that included Tenzing Galzin, Lakpa, Urkin, Futashi, Nima Rita, and Fura Sherpa, among others, and they were so important to our team's success, particularly in carrying all the key components of the weather stations up the mountain and in helping with the installation itself.
Fantastico.
Fantastic. Can you tell us a little bit more about the goal of the expedition? Well, you had to set up these weather stations in various places, especially above 8,000 meters. But can you tell us a little bit more about why it's so important and what we'll be able to understand and what we've already understood, if anything?
Well, the Hindu Kush Karakoram Himalayan mountain region provides critical fresh water to over 1 billion people. And these glacierized high mountain regions are water towers, and they sustain environmental and human demands downstream. But the world's supply of fresh water is in trouble as the mountain ice vanishes and disappears. And so we do not fully understand the meteorological processes driving the glacier changes, as there are only a handful of weather stations above about 5,000 meters across the region. And this is despite the fact that this is where the snow and ice is located. And so the data that we have collected already from these weather stations has told us that the air streams arriving from the Bay of Bengal, for example, furnish the upper mountain with more heat and moisture than we thought was possible, fueling storm clouds that can even tower above the summit. And this influx of heat, coupled with what may be the most extreme sunlight and some of the strongest winds on Earth, can remove many years of ice accumulation in a single season, we now know. And this reveals the precariousness of this environment to the ongoing warming that we have identified. And so fundamental are the changes that the rising temperatures are even increasing the amount of oxygen available to climbers as the entire atmosphere warms. Now, the scientific understanding that we have generated has led to even bigger questions. And critically, we now believe that the summit snowpack on the very top of Mount Everest may be on the verge of melt and sublimation. And this is widespread melt and sublimation, perhaps for the first time in human history. And then beyond the globally significant story of snow and ice loss from the world's highest mountain, our research has also highlighted the acute dangers that Everest's weather, and especially the winds, play for mountaineers. And we have found evidence that winds, in fact, can be strong enough to be a major threat, and that this danger can be very, very severe, even when conditions appear calm, with so-called rogue gusts, or these surprise gusts potentially responsible for some of the unresolved disappearances on Mount Everest.
Grazie, Dante, sta affascinante quando parlare.
Thank you very much for this fascinating overview of these extreme environments. Which brings me to the last question, connected to what you were mentioning regarding the changes in these places and their possible consequences. So can you elaborate? Can you tell us a little bit more about the possible consequences of all of these changes that you are witnessing, that you're recording?
Yeah, so some findings, again, that I can expand upon. Our work has found that just since 2005, the freezing level has risen about 7 meters per year. And this is driving continued rapid deglaciation and also the growth of new glacier lakes. We see that more rain is falling in the lower ablation zones of the glaciers, resulting in lower reflectivity of that sunlight and less snow accumulation during the monsoon when temperatures are high. As I said, melt may now be occurring even on the summit of Mount Everest. And this loss of ice is now occurring in winter, as documented by our weather stations in a recent paper that we published. The rapid growth of new glacier lakes combined with greater instability of rock faces and ice falls above the lakes increases the risks of glacier lake outburst floods. And perhaps most importantly, the loss of the snow and ice signifies reduced stream flow downstream, particularly during drier periods of the year when runoff is needed, and really threatens the water security for millions of people. And from a climbing perspective, the loss of snow and ice makes many routes more difficult and increases the hazards from falling rock, and in some cases even limits the water availability at camps. And so these changes in the extreme environments that we have documented are having major consequences for sure.
Grazie anche del lavoro importantissimo che state facendo.
Thank you for the very important work you're also developing, which will hopefully help us avoid the consequences you were mentioning. So let me perhaps ask you one last question before we move to our third guest. Can you tell us something more about your experience above 8,000 meters? We saw that in the video. It's especially difficult and risky to go up there. Can you tell us something more about the challenges you faced that your entire team had to face to get up there?
Yes, the margin of error above 8,000 meters is very small due to the limited oxygen and the extreme weather. I think you saw in the video that in my case, my oxygen mask froze up. This was on the way up to the balcony in the middle of the night, and this severely limited my oxygen intake and clouded my judgment. I had to lift my mask up off my face to get full breaths of air. And we knew that there were going to be challenges working up there, and the extreme cold, the need for supplemental oxygen limited our window to 2 to 3 hours max to complete the installation. And therefore, we worked very closely with our colleagues at Campbell Scientific to make the setup as quick and as simple as possible for the two higher stations there at the South Call and the balcony. And we made sure that everything could be installed with bulky gloves or mittens on, and with only two hand tools needed. There were a few challenges that we faced during the installation. One of those you saw on the video with the batteries for the drill being a bit too cold, and we had to wait a little while to warm those up. The other challenge was when we arrived and unpacked everything from the different loads, we realized that the key mounts to the wind sensors were missing. And so we had to think quickly, and fortunately had a shovel in our bags that the handles were nearly the same diameter for the mounts that were missing. And so we were able to substitute those. And so that was a major challenge that provided a bit of an interesting story that we had to overcome with some real teamwork there. So yeah, it's not an easy place to just function, let alone do scientific research up at these extreme elevations.
Grazie, Baker Perry, veramente affascinante.
Thank you very much, Baker Perry, for this extraordinary story. We'll be coming back to you, but let me move on to our third guest.
Heggie, che ringrazio anche lei di essere con noi, non ho ringraziato nessuno, ma ringrazio i nostri ospiti di essere.
To Vanessa Heggie, I thank her for being with us. Vanessa Heggie teaches history of science and medicine at the University of Birmingham. She is also a prolific science writer and a keen advocate of public engagement of science. She has focused a lot on biomedical research and human physiology in extreme environments. She recently wrote a book, Higher and Colder, in Alto al Gelo, in Italian, which tells us about human survival in these environments. So I'll leave the floor to her.
Thank you so much. I want to share a couple of slides with you. These aren't quite as fancy as the videos we've seen, but I just wanted to show some images. And I want to say it's an enormous honor to be here, especially with these other two speakers. And I wanted to admit that I am a complete fraud. I am a historian. I am not a mountaineer. And the highest I have ever been is pictured on this slide here. This is the Jungfrau in the Swiss Alps. And I got up there on a train. I didn't even have to climb. But actually, there's a connection between this site and Everest, which is that this is the place where in the 1950s, British scientists tested the oxygen equipment that was going to go up Everest for the first time to the summit in 1953. My main focus as a historian is physiology and medicine in these extreme spaces. And one of the real challenges of doing work there is that you cannot effectively test your equipment and your ideas in a laboratory. It's very hard to model Everest when you're at sea level. And therefore, quite a lot of the scientific debates about medicine and biology on Everest are debates between people who work in labs and people who do field work. And those arguments go right back to the 19th century. The picture I'm showing here is the French researcher Paul Bert, and he's inside a barometric chamber. In 1874, he wrote that he had gone to the summit of Everest inside this chamber. And his research was to try and understand altitude sickness, which he thought was just to do with oxygen. He showed here that he could get as high as Everest and he felt completely fine as long as he kept breathing the gas. When he stopped breathing the gas, he started to feel sick and dizzy. So the problem with altitude was oxygen. Simple to solve. Except it wasn't that simple, of course, in the real world. For example, the Italian scientist Angelo Mosso, round about the turn of the century, does a lot of research in the Alps, in alpine laboratories like the one pictured here on Monte Rosa. And he pointed out that actually sometimes when you tried to use oxygen to treat altitude sickness, it didn't help. It didn't make people feel better. In addition, mountain sickness wasn't always predictable. Sometimes you'd climb a mountain and feel fine, and then another year you'd climb it and you'd get sick. And he suggested that it's more complicated than what Paul Burt said, and actually perhaps it had something to do with tiredness or fatigue. And that's not something you can test for if you're just sitting still in a barometric chamber. And that's why other mountains like the Alps were used as test sites, referred to as natural laboratories, to test out theories in physiology, but also to test out the technology like the oxygen systems. And that's what I'm really interested in as a historian. In the 20th century, it was very easy to think of science as being something you did in a laboratory, not in the conditions we've just seen in the previous videos where you're struggling with lack of oxygen or in the environment is so dangerous and you don't have control of it. So one of the real challenges in these spaces is it turns out that there's a lot of unpredictability on Everest and in other extreme environments. People have different metabolisms. They have different psychologies. Sometimes they're tired, sometimes they're determined, sometimes they're excited, and that affects how their bodies respond to the environment. And also, you can't just think of one factor like the lack of oxygen. You also have to consider the whole environment, for example, the winds, the cold, and the other problems that the climbers face. And one of the big problems with early oxygen kits, these are the ones that were used in the 1920s and the 1930s, is actually they weren't very good in low temperatures. The valves and the other delicate parts often froze or broke, which, as we've just heard, is something that can still happen today. And one of the problems too was the physiologists had underestimated how much oxygen you would need on the summit of Everest. And so they weren't in fact breathing enough oxygen to compensate for the really heavy weight of the awkwardness of these particular packs. And this leads to, I think, one of the biggest misunderstandings about science on Everest. The British teams on the mountains had a big debate about whether or not to use oxygen. And a lot of British historians like to write about that as being about class. They like to say these were elite mountaineers who did not want to use science or do training because they thought that was against the ethos of the elite British gentleman, that only professional people or working class people trained. In fact, much of the argument was about how bad these early oxygen sets were when they actually got to Everest. They broke, they froze, they didn't supply enough oxygen. And so there were a lot of reasons to reject this sort of oxygen, and some of them were quite good scientific reasons, and they were based on real experience of the systems. Nonetheless, every British team, in fact, every European team who tried to climb Everest all had a go at trying to improve the oxygen equipment. And often what you see is this feedback loop where you test in the lab, you test in the field, you make adjustments, and then you feed that back and you create a loop of understanding to improve the science and the technology. Now, by 1953, this technology had got better, in part because of the research into aviation, because of World War I and World War II that had made better oxygen sets. But once someone got to the summit of Everest using oxygen, the question changed, and now it was perhaps, can you get to Everest without using oxygen? And so a lot of the medical research focused more on training, getting fit for climbing, and about acclimatization. So that's the adaptations that the human body can make in order to survive at altitude. So for example, if you go from sea level to altitude, one of the first things that happens is your breathing rate changes in order to compensate for not having so much oxygen. After a couple of days, you might find you're producing more red blood cells to help transport the oxygen around your body and so on. And there are all sorts of adaptations. And these, again, very hard to test in a laboratory. Partly because it's individual, every individual responds slightly differently. It's very obvious that populations that live at altitude, such as in the high Andes or in the high Himalaya, perform better at altitude than people who live at sea level. But it was not obvious whether that was something genetic that you would inherit, or if it was something that everybody could achieve if they just spent enough time at altitude. And these sorts of research questions highlighted some of the limitations about using Everest and other mountains as natural laboratories. That meant that right until the 1980s, almost nothing was known about women's bodies on Everest because they were almost always excluded from these sorts of expeditions. And almost all of the subjects of these studies were white Europeans. Some attention perhaps paid to some indigenous South American populations in the Andes, but Himalayan populations were all pretty much ignored until the end of the 20th century. So the natural laboratory was not perfect. It couldn't or it didn't study every single type of body. But there were also problems with using normal laboratories. And I think some of those have been highlighted by the fact that these meteorological stations were only just being set up on Everest. One of the problems with Everest was that no one had really taken actual barometric pressures up there. So they were, everyone was having to guess what the air pressure was and how much oxygen was going to be available. And what they were using to guess was the International Civil Aviation Organization's standard atmosphere. That's a average atmosphere that's used for the design of aeroplanes. But the thing is, the real atmosphere is not average. In fact, it's thicker at the equator and it's thinner at the poles. So there's more atmospheric pressure on Everest in the Himalaya than if we picked Everest up and put it in Europe, for example. And therefore, that meant that some of the models that the physiologists were using turned out to be wrong when they finally took barometric pressure readings on the real Everest itself. The weather matters too, just to make things more complicated. Air pressure, high or low, will change the amount of available oxygen. Climate change, as we've heard, is changing the amount of available oxygen. So the more measurements people were able to take on the mountain, the better the laboratory models could become, but they could never completely replicate the real experience of being on the mountain. So by the 1980s, there had been more than 100 years of work into the science of survival at altitude from Paul Bear onwards. Climbers knew a lot more about the risks and a lot more about the opportunities. The technology was much better, although it's still not perfect. And we understood more about how the body responds to altitude. There were lots of other discoveries too. So I focus on oxygen, but work was done on the right food to take, the right training to do, the right drugs and stimulants if you wanted to use them on the mountainside. And so Everest became slightly safer for scientists to use, but it's still a very risky space. So that, I think that's just a very quick highlight of some of the ways that the challenge of Everest is overcome, but also how the challenge of Everest is quite a useful sort of laboratory for scientists to do all sorts of work. So for example, you can do studies on climbers who are fit and active and moving around on the mountain, but their oxygen level is as low as really, really sick patients in intensive care units. You couldn't possibly do experimental work on those sick patients, but you can do it on the mountaineers to try and understand and to help the patients you've got in emergency rooms across the world. So sometimes those extreme environments are the challenge, but sometimes the challenge actually gives you new opportunities. Okay, that's all of my presentation. Thank you so much for your attention.
Bellissimo, grazie.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very, very interesting. Thank you for sharing your point of view. So I'll start with I have a question for each one of you, if you could briefly give us an answer. So I'll start from Vanessa. You mentioned this, the fact that it was a bit of a Western, a bit of a man-focused story, male-focused story, but you say in your book that women play an important role. They've always played an important role ever since the beginning, and it was somehow obscured. Can you tell us more about it?
Sure, I can. So there were a few early European physiologists who did some quite important work in the early understanding of how the lungs process different gases. But where I generally find women is in places where they've been hidden or ignored. Like sometimes it's turned out that researchers went out to the Himalaya and they took with them a team of researchers. And one of those researchers was a woman, and she contributed significantly to, in this case, it was cardiological research, so research on the heart rather than breathing. But when they published the scientific papers, they never mentioned that she was there. They didn't even say they had an assistant. They would just publish it under their own names. So some of the work I've had to do as a historian is to kind of do quite a lot of investigation and discovery to find these women whose roles have been hidden. And that's not even including the Sherpa porters, who are never named and no one ever mentions them. And yet they're carrying, and often they're women, and they're carrying this really important scientific equipment. And the expedition couldn't possibly have happened without them. And I think it's worth giving them credit too, because the science could not happen on Everest if it had not been for their assistance. So it's, for me, it's about finding the women who are already there, but they're just there, and it doesn't give us details of what they've done.
Okay, grazie mille.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Vanessa. I'll now move on to Baker Perry. A quick question. we have seen this a great enterprise you have taken part in. What are your plans for the future? Are you looking to climb another mountain? Any expeditions coming up?
Our plans for the future are to continue to operate and maintain the weather stations that we installed on Everest as long as possible. Of course, this is working very closely with our Nepali partners, our Sherpa team members, and Nepali scientists from Tribhuvan University and also the Department of Hydrology and Meteorology with the government of Nepal. And we are working on plans to expand observational networks in these high, extreme high mountain environments and to build the local capacity to operate and maintain the weather stations in places like the Andes Mountains and perhaps elsewhere. And I think what has become apparent is just how little we actually know about the outer regions of our planet. And these are the highest summits, not only in the Himalayas, but in other mountain regions around the world. And this has to do with air pressure, as Vanessa spoke about. It has to do with solar radiation, has to do with wind speed and wind direction. So many of the basic meteorological processes we just have not had observations for. And so I think a major goal that I have is to expand these observational networks as we move to the future.
Va bene, grazie mille. Baker, allora chiuderei con Dawa.
Thank you very much, Baker. Dawa, one more question for you. If you can tell us about your next climb. And a question about oxygen. I know that you climbed Annapurna without oxygen. What's the difference? What does it truly mean to climb one of these mountains without oxygen? Could you think you could climb Mount Everest without oxygen?
Is this for me?
Yes, yes.
Oh, yeah. I've been always guiding on Everest as working. So when you guide on Everest, it's kind of hard to go without oxygen because we need to watch. We need to take care of ourselves first, and then we need to take care of other. And so I never tried oxygen without oxygen on Everest. My first 8,000 on without oxygen was Mount Annapurna 1, and which is just 8,080 meter, like right above 8,000 meter. So I thought this is the mountain that I want to try, and I was not guiding there. I was climbing by myself. So that was, I thought about, okay, this is the right time that I can see myself, because I born in 4,000 meter. And of course I need to acclimatize, and my body is very, very different than Western, because we adapt a little faster. And but we never been to without. So Annapurna, I was not guiding, and I was just climbing myself. So I tried, and it was a little difficult after 8,000 meter peak. I think, you know, I feel like it's kind of hard breathing and it's way difficult. So yes, I've been training. I have been trained a lot, so that's how I climbing 8,000 meter peak, but I still on training, and hopefully I will be able to climb Mount Everest without oxygen one day, and I'm still training for that. And I think I don't do a lot of like a training exercise, which is, but I think growing up in my high mountain, I think from the childhood, we've been working outside and carrying water, carrying loads kind of was my training to become a mountaineer. So still I'm training on Everest or to work without oxygen on different mountains. So when I'm guiding, I'm not able to do without oxygen, but in the future, I think I have a goal that I want to try out without oxygen one day, and yeah.
Va bene, grazie mille, molto impressionante.
Thank you very much. I think we can end it here. I thank our guests for their very interesting presentations on science and mountain climbing and extreme environments. I thank you all for being with us and hope to see you soon.